All right, so something most of you may already know about me, but maybe you haven't figured it out yet. I'm the type of person who doesn't like to dwell on the negative. Okay, I try to stay pretty positive in my interactions. I love to celebrate positive things happening around me, and I would rather just not deal with the negative. However, I know that sometimes it must be dealt with. But in general, I just think there's so much in life to be thankful for. Why spend time focusing on the negative? And so I believe that because of this, the story of the life of David is actually a story that I'm instantly drawn to in Scripture. It's kind of this rags to riches, shepherd boy to king story, with God right in the middle of it. It has some climactic scenes between David and Saul and David and Jonathan and David and Goliath. And David is this valiant warrior who fights and wins many battles. He is a man of faith. He is called a man after God's own heart. And he becomes this mighty king who, as we have seen, God blesses greatly. You know, I may have mentioned this before, but did you know that more is written about David than any other character in the Old Testament? There are 66 chapters written about David. Then he is also believed to have written at least 75 chapters in the Psalms, where we gain more insight into who David was. And not only that, but then also in the New Testament, there are at least 59 references to David. So I have really been enjoying studying and sharing the life of David. But in the back of my mind, I have known that today's text was coming. And I'll be honest, I haven't been looking forward to it. But here we are, and obviously there are some valuable truths and lessons that we need to learn from this chapter. And so that is what we are going to try to do today. If you have your Bible, I would encourage you to open to 2 Samuel chapter 11 so that you can follow along with our text today. If you don't have your Bible, I'd encourage you, grab the one from the pew back in front of you and open it up so that you can follow along. I really feel that you'll get the most out of the message if you follow along. I've also heard it said that the sound of pages turning scares the devil away, okay? I don't know if that's true, but what I do know is the devil does not like this book and the truth that is found in it, and he doesn't like people who open it up and take it seriously. And so that's what we want to do today. So let's start reading here. 2 Samuel chapter 11, starting in verse 1. It says, "In the spring, at the time when kings go off to war, David sent Joab out with the king's men and the whole army, Israelite army. They destroyed the Ammonites and besieged Rabbah, but David remained in Jerusalem." Now, the first thing that might seem kind of strange to us in this very first verse was that there was actually a time of year that was called the war season. Like now we have football season, we have hunting season, we have harvest season. In that time, they actually had a war season. Practically speaking, during the rainy season, it was very difficult to go out and fight battles with all the chariots and horses and equipment and camps. So in the spring of the year, right at the end of the rainy season, the land would dry up. And very practically speaking, that is when the kings and their armies would head out to do battle with other nations. It was war season. Now, I also want to mention to you that in the ancient world, kings were not just figureheads or office managers or public figures. Kings were actually warriors. They were the commanders who usually led the armies into battle. That was actually the primary function of king in the ancient world. But here we read in verse 1 that David chose not to go out to battle, but rather he just sends Joab and the army out. Many Bible commentators would say this is the first red flag that something is about to go wrong. Verse 2. One evening, David got up from his bed and walked around on the roof of the palace. From the roof, he saw a woman bathing. The woman was very beautiful, and David sent someone to find out about her. The man said, "She is Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, and the wife of Uriah the Hittite." So David gets up in the evening from his afternoon nap. You know, it would have been common in that time for people to take a nap right after lunch in the heat of the day and then get up later in the afternoon and work into the evening. However, the language here would seem to imply that David had taken an all-afternoon nap. Like David had been either feeling lazy or bored and didn't get up until well into the evening. That would appear to be another red flag. You know, you might have heard the saying, or it's saying similar to this, the devil finds work for idle hands. While Joab and the army are out fighting in battle, David stays back at the palace and is taking long naps and is bored and is restless. This doesn't sound like the valiant warrior David that we have been talking about. You know, it's also interesting to note here, what are the times in life when we are the most vulnerable to temptation? It is usually actually not during the times in the wilderness. David's time in the wilderness did not put him at risk nearly as much as this time of unbelievable success and comfort. And I think we can learn from that. When we are going through trial and hardship in life, for the most part, that is when we recognize our need for God. And we lean even harder into his presence and his will. But when we're comfortable and complacent and life is good, that is when we are much more likely to forget about our need for God and forget about doing things his way. So David is out walking on the roof of the palace. The palace is obviously high and overlooks the rest of the city. And so there he sees a very beautiful woman bathing. In this chapter, you will notice that there are moments all along where David has the chance to rethink what is on his mind, where he has the chance to change his direction, to make a correction, and to not fall into temptation and sin and disaster. You may know that in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, Paul talks about how when we are tempted, God always provides a way out, but it is up to us if we will take that or not. And here, David does not do that. Rather, he chooses to get a little closer to the temptation and the sin and the disaster. He chooses to send someone down to find out who this woman is. And word comes back to David that she is the daughter of Eliam and the wife of Uriah the Hittite. Now, it's actually very unusual in Hebrew text to identify a woman by both their father and their husband. What we know about Eliam and Uriah is that they were both valiant warriors. They were not just regular men in the army. Both were among the elite warriors, like the Navy SEALs or the Army Rangers. We also know that Bathsheba was the granddaughter of one of David's favorite counselors, Ahithophel. All this to say that she belongs to a family that has been dedicated and loyal to the service of King David. I think this is another moment when David finds out who Bathsheba was, that she was a wife and has a family, that he could have realized the path he was headed down, and he could have changed his thinking and his direction and made a correction, and therefore avoided even greater sin and disaster. But David didn't do that. Verse 4. Then David sent messengers to get her. She came to him, and he slept with her. Now she was purifying herself from her monthly uncleansing. Then she went back home. The woman conceived and sent word to David, saying, I am pregnant. So David sends for Bathsheba to come to the palace. The writer doesn't share a lot of unnecessary details, but it says David slept with her and then sent her back home. You know, there's a lot of ideas written in Bible commentaries about, well, what was Bathsheba's part in all of this? And the ideas range from one extreme, that she was raped, to the other extreme, that she was promiscuous and wanted this to happen, and you'll find everything in between. We don't know, because the text doesn't clearly tell us. But what we do know for sure, and what the text is clear about, is what it says about David. This was David's choice, it was David's fault, and it was obviously completely wrong. So David sends Bathsheba home, and there is obviously a gap in time until she realizes she is pregnant, and the text doesn't tell us what's going through David's mind during that time. Did he immediately feel guilt and shame for what he had done, or did he think that he had just gotten away with it because of his power and his position as king? You know, I'm going to guess that he felt great shame and guilt, but was going to try to pretend that it never happened and move on. But you know what? That never really works with unrepentant sin in our lives, does it? Next, David receives the message that Bathsheba is pregnant. This is another moment in the story where David could have stopped, realized the sin he had already committed, and made the decision to repent, to do the right thing, to turn away from this horrible sin. But rather, we see David do exactly what we saw Adam and Eve do in the book of Genesis. David decides he is going to try to hide his sin. He is going to try to cover up the wrong he has done rather than confessing and repenting. So in verse 6, David goes into cover-up plan A. Let's read. So David sent this word to Joab, send me Uriah the Hittite. And Joab sent him to David. When Uriah came to him, David asked him how Joab was, how the soldiers were, and how the war was going. Then David said to Uriah, go down to your house and wash your feet. So Uriah left the palace, and a gift from the king was sent after him. But Uriah slept at the entrance to the palace with all his master's servants and did not go down to his house. David was told Uriah did not go home. So he asked Uriah, haven't you just come from a military campaign? Why didn't you go home? Uriah said to David, the ark and Israel and Judah are staying in tents, and my commander Joab and my lord's men are camped in the open country. How could I go to my house to eat and drink and make love to my wife? As surely as you live, I will not do such a thing. So cover up plan A. Bring Uriah back from battle. Have him go home and sleep with his wife, and he will think the child is his. So David sends word to Joab to send Uriah back to him. When Uriah gets back, David starts with a little small talk. He asks him, how's Joab? How's the army? How's the battle going? But notice that the text doesn't even answer those questions. It's like the writer is saying, that's obviously not why David sent for Uriah. So then David tells Uriah to go home and wash his feet. In our modern time, this would be like saying, hey, why don't you go home, take a nice hot shower, and enjoy the evening with your wife. But Uriah doesn't choose to do this. Rather, he spends the night with David's other servants at the entrance to the palace. The next morning, when David finds out, he calls for Uriah and asks him why he didn't go home. Uriah gives David a reason that is filled with character and integrity. It was written in the law that a soldier was not to go home and have relations with his wife while the nation was at war. And Uriah knew that, and he was not going to go against God's law, and he was not going to disrespect his fellow soldiers or his king in that way. So now what? David moves on to cover up plan B. Verse 12. Then David said to him, to Uriah, "Stay here one more day, and tomorrow I will send you back." So Uriah remained in Jerusalem that day and the next. At David's invitation, he ate and drank with him, and David made him drunk. But in the evening, Uriah went out to sleep on his mat among his master's servants. He did not go home. So plan B, get Uriah drunk. Maybe then he won't have so much character and integrity and will go home and be with his wife. But Uriah doesn't go home. One commentator that I read said it this way: in this story, a drunken Hittite warrior shows more character integrity than the Hebrew sober king. What a sad moment in the life of David. But he moves right along to cover up plan C. Verse 14. In the morning, David wrote a letter to Joab and sent it with Uriah. In it he wrote, "Put Uriah out in front where the fighting is fiercest. Then withdraw from him so he will be struck down and die." So while Joab had the city under siege, he put Uriah at a place where he knew the strongest defenders were. Then the men of the city came out and fought against Joab. Some of the men of David's army fell. Moreover, Uriah the Hittite died. Joab sent David a full account of the battle, and he instructed the messenger, "When you have finished giving the king this account of the battle, the king's anger may flare up, and he may ask you, 'Why did you get so close to the city to fight? Didn't you know they would shoot arrows from the wall? Who killed Abimelech, son of Jerubbaal-Besheth? Didn't a woman drop an upper millstone on him from the wall so that he died at Thebez? Why did you get so close to the wall?'" And this is still Joab talking to the messenger. "If he asks you this, then say to him, 'Moreover, your servant Uriah the Hittite is dead.'" So David sends Uriah back to Joab with his own death notice in hand. Joab reads these instructions from the king, and Joab wasn't dumb. He obviously didn't actually think this was a good idea, but he understood what David was asking, and he was going to obey the king's orders and do what David told him to do. But he couldn't obviously send Uriah out by himself to get killed, so this basic suicide mission would also cost more lives, more soldiers, when he sent Uriah to attack the city. After this, Joab calls a messenger to take this message back to King David. But Joab tells the messenger that there's the possibility that King David will be angry that he's lost so many soldiers and that they made this foolish military decision. David may bring up the story from Judges, where they learn that if you get too close to a city wall, you will get killed. In that story, a woman dropped a millstone off the wall and it killed Abimelech, from Judges chapter 9. I believe Joab's point in saying all this to the messenger was to make sure David understood, "Hey, king, I did what you told me to do. It did cost the nation greatly, and it's your fault, David, not mine." You know, when we try to cover up sin in our lives, we may want to believe that it is only affecting us, but covered up, unrepentant sin always ends up, either directly or indirectly, hurting others as well. Verse 22, the messenger set out, and when he arrived, he told David everything Joab had sent him to say. The messenger said to David, "The men overpowered us and came out against us in the open, but we drove them back to the entrance of the city gate. Then the archers shot arrows at your servant from the wall, and some of the king's men died. Moreover, your servant Uriah the Hittite is dead." David told the messenger, "Say this to Joab, Don't let this upset you. The sword devours one as well as another. Press the attack against the city and destroy it. Say this to encourage Joab. Church, this response from David is honestly so disturbing and shows us just how far this sin has caused him to slip. When I read this, my first thought is this even the same man? The same man who has shown so much bravery and courage and devotion to the Lord? Well, the truth is, it is the same man. And it is amazing and honestly devastating to see what sin can do to someone when it gets a hold in their life. The messenger tells David what happened and about the lives that were lost, including Uriah. And David's response is basically, hey, you know what? You win some, you lose some. No big deal. Finish the job and come home. We see no sign of grief or mourning over the needless lives lost. Just a heartless statement. Don't let this upset you. The sword devours one as well as another. Can you imagine a president or country leader or military leader, whether it's one you like or not, just coming out after some members of the armed forces have been killed in battle and saying, hey, you know what? Don't be upset. You win some, you lose some. Oh, well. That is basically what David told this messenger, because all that he could think about was, well, at least my problem for my sin has been taken care of. David's heart was as hard as stone. Verse 26, when Uriah's wife heard that her husband was dead, she mourned for him. After the time of mourning was over, David had her brought to his house, and she became his wife and bore him a son. Bathsheba gets word that her husband is dead, and so obviously she goes into a time of mourning the death of her husband. Now, in that culture, in that time, the normal time of mourning would have been about 7 days. And so sometime after that, David takes her as his wife, and she bears him a son. Now, I will say, on the surface level, practically speaking, it appears here that David has gotten away with this great sin and injustice, with multiple sins and injustice. My guess would be that only a handful of people who were close to David could actually connect the dots and actually knew what had happened. But because of David's power and his position, even they weren't going to say or do anything. But the majority of the nation of Israel would probably never know what had even happened. It looks as if David has gotten away with it, except for the last sentence of the chapter, where we read, but the thing David had done displeased the Lord. And honestly, I don't really like how the NIV words that. I don't think it's strong enough. The New American Standard Version says, the thing David had done was evil in the sight of the Lord. Church, in life, we may feel like we get away with certain sins or injustices or evil actions or thoughts. But the truth we see here is that God always knows. David is a man of unbelievable power and position. And in this chapter, we read of his gross abuse of power. And on a surface human level, it almost seems like David is going to get away with his sin. But we are reminded right at the end that you never really get away with sin in your life, because God always sees. At the end of this chapter, we are left with this feeling that this story is not over. There will be repercussions to come because of David's evil, sinful actions. And I'll just let you know, we'll get to that next week. But as we wrap up this very sad and uncomfortable and heartbreaking story this morning, I want us all to do some soul searching and ask ourselves this question: where do you find yourself in the David story today? My hope would be that maybe you relate most to Uriah, who shows unbelievable courage and character in service to the Lord. But maybe, just maybe, there is an unrepentant sin currently in your life. And I know this story automatically points us to sexual sin, but really it could apply to any type of sin: greed, envy, lust, pride, adultery, gluttony, anger. Maybe this sin is just in the beginning stages, like David on the rooftop, where he had just seen something, and it might not have even really been his fault that he saw what he saw, but now he had a choice if he was going to dwell on it and pursue it, or if he was going to cut it off right there and repent of it and turn from it. Or maybe there's a sin in your life that you've allowed to stick around and to start to take hold in your thought life. You don't think you would ever actually act on it, but it is very much present in your life. Or maybe you're even here today or watching online, and there is something that you know that God has been convicting you of, and you're in it deep. You are to the point where you are covering it up, and it is leading to more sin or to possibly even hurting others in your life. Whatever the case may be, the message and challenge and encouragement that I have for you right now is, don't let it go any further. Don't let it take hold anymore. Don't let it stick around any longer. Make the choice today to repent of that sin, to turn away from that thought process or that situation or that action, and allow Christ to lead you to experiencing forgiveness and grace and redemption. We're going to listen to a song this morning called Honestly. It's by a band named Voda out of Lincoln. And I want us all to really soak in the lyrics to this song and allow ourselves to be vulnerable and ask ourselves, is there anything in my life that I have been trying to hide from God or from others, but I need to make the choice today to be honest with myself, to be honest with God, maybe even to be honest with someone else, and truly seek repentance and forgiveness. Watch this video.
Killing us inside.
Wow. If you don't see the real me, you won't see what grace has done. If you don't see the real me, or if you don't see my weakness, you won't see what love has won. If you don't see the distance from the darkness to the sun, you won't see Christ. We have to learn to be honest with ourselves, honest with others, and honest with God about the sin that is present in our lives and our need for repentance and forgiveness and grace. But I don't want to leave us today focused on the sin. I want us to leave this morning focusing on the forgiveness and what God did to make that forgiveness possible and available to us by sending his son, Jesus, to pay the payment for our sins. The truth is that when Jesus died on the cross, he paid for David's sins, just like he paid for each and every one of yours and each and every one of mine. And that is what makes the cross and Christ's sacrifice so amazing. So we're going to close the service this morning by remembering the amazing sacrifice of Christ and partaking in communion together. Servers, if you would come forward at this time, I'm going to pray. And then if, as you're served, if you would just hold the elements until everyone has been served, and then we will partake together. Anyone is invited to partake in communion with us if you have trusted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. But if you're not comfortable or don't understand, just feel free to pass the elements on by as well. And so as we pass the elements after I pray, and as you're sitting there waiting to partake this morning, I would encourage you to reflect on what Christ has done. Reflect on the sin, your sin, that Christ has taken to the cross. And if there is any unrepentant sin that you are currently holding on to in your life, I would strongly encourage you to take this time to be honest with God and to repent of that sin, to lay it down at the foot of the cross. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, it's not easy to be vulnerable, to be honest, to admit our shortcomings, our failures, our sins. But God, that is when you are magnified the most. When we admit our shortcomings, our failures, our sins, and allow your grace and your forgiveness and your redemption to flood into our lives, that is when Christ's love and who he is and what he came to this earth to do shines through the most. And so, God, as we take this time to reflect and to remember through the way that you gave us to do just that, by reflecting on the body of Christ that was broken for us, for our sins, the blood of Christ that was shed to cover our sins so that we can be seen as holy and righteous and forgiven in your sight, God, I pray that you would help us to reflect and to be thankful. And God, if there be any unrepentant sin currently present in our life, God, I pray that right now, where we sit, would be the opportunity we take to confess, to repent of that sin, to turn from it, to draw a line in the sand and say, no more will I allow this to take hold and to impact my life. God, we pray that through this bread and this cup, we would be united with you, our Lord and Savior, and with one another, our brothers and sisters in Christ. It is in his precious name we pray. Amen.